So my essay is "With an Open Mind and Open Heart." During my first semester of college, I had what my mom told me was a stereotypical college existential crisis. On an average day, you could have found me in my dorm room reading Sylvia Plath's The Bell Jar with the blinds drawn and eating cereal straight out of the box. I had basically no friends and didn't really want any. I had no idea what I wanted to do long term, and I hadn't found my place in this new part of my life yet. I knew that I had a lot of passion to pour into something, but for some reason, my basic history, international affairs, and geography classes weren't igniting a fire in me. So I knew I needed to change things up for my second semester. I decided to register for GWS 200 to take something I was actually interested in as opposed to something I had to take, and it was one of the best decisions I could have made. It was in this class that I read Marilyn Frye's Oppression, which captivated my attention from the very first paragraph. Frye begins by tackling the concept of oppression, which I had always defined in theoretical terms as an act that happened over there or back then, separate from myself, but as I continued in the class, I learned about the forms of oppression that women, myself included, face daily. I remember coming back to her explanation of oppression again and again. She described it as a press, which is used to mold things or flatten them or reduce them. I remembered all the times which I felt flattened or reduced by men, by situations, and by society. I started to feel my bones crack under the weight of my own experiences. I began wondering why I was allowing others to make me feel so small and insignificant. I worked hard to keep up with my peers and prove myself worthy of respect, so why should I make less money or not be taken seriously? Frye had an answer, although not a particularly comforting one. With her metaphor of the birdcage, I understood the systemic qualities of oppressions that cage you in from every direction. Each step is a misstep until you're exactly as the system wants you to be. Understanding oppression from a macroscopic perspective was disheartening, to say the least. While I left the class enlightened, I was also concerned about what might be done in the face of these types of systemic issues. It was enough to inspire me to add diversity and community studies as my second major, because a GWS minor didn't seem to be enough to cover all of the issues that I was interested in. A year later, after an amazing study abroad trip with Semester at Sea, during which I saw much of the world, its beauties, and its problems, I found myself back in the States and taking my first DCS class, Public Problem Solving, and participating in a $100 solution project for another class. Plagued by my unanswered questions of how in the world to even begin to fight oppression, these two learning experiences began to shape my understanding of how to tackle wicked problems. Of course, these didn't teach me how to magically undo the isms of Western society, but instead they did teach me how to think critically about solutions to community-level problems. Since these problems are systematic in nature, we had to learn to think about them systemically as well. That means looking for the deeper problem at the root and not merely trying to solve the effects of the problem. For example, in my $100 solution project, I worked with a local organization called Top Crops. They told us that their biggest problem was advertising for their farm, so they wanted a sign. Instead of just giving them money for a sign and providing an easy band-aid solution, my group created a fundraiser for the organization. We used a small grant to carry out this fundraiser, giving them the proceeds along with a manual on how to accomplish similar results the next year. Not only did I enjoy working within the community, I felt proud of myself and my group for helping Top Crops in a way that they can recreate themselves. It wasn't just service anymore, it was empowerment. That project was entirely influenced not only by the pillars of the $100 solution, but also the need to steer clear of better before worse behavior. This concept is explained by David Stroh as alleviating short-term pressures and fears without understanding the potential negative consequences of expedient solutions. Would it have helped Top Crops to just give them money for a sign? Of course, but what about the next time they needed new advertisements, a new sign, or new equipment? Would there always be a group working on a project to help them out? Probably not. So instead of throwing money at the problem and making the organization dependent on outside help, we were able to provide them with strategic ways to raise money for new projects in the future. This was great and fulfilling work, but I still felt that it was dodging the larger issues at play. I wanted to make big change. A year later, I was fortunate enough to take another study abroad trip, this time to Northern Ireland and then to Jordan. While in Jordan, I lived with a Syrian and Palestinian host family, falling in love with them and their culture. Learning about their struggles in the Middle East, I became passionate about international service, and upon returning to Bowling Green, I started working with No Lost Generation and the local International Center to connect with refugees in our community. After the presidential election, this kind of work became even more difficult and draining. A lot of the United States became disillusioned with the plight of the refugee, even in the face of the refugee crisis. With Syrians pouring out of their war-torn country, Rohingya being forced out for their lives, not to mention the countless refugees coming from several African countries. It felt like American hearts had been frozen, and fear of unemployment, terrorism, or people that were just different had increased discrimination and antagonism towards these new members of society. So what could I do to combat this? Thinking back to CSJ 200, I remembered the role that education and advocacy can play in social issues. Christopher Merritt, a geographer that researches social justice and community development, reminds us that teachers can either offer an uncritical, neutral education that supports the status quo, or choose to empower students to question dominant ideas, possibly leading to social change. This, along with the many activities I participated in with No Lost Generation, made me realize the importance of education and advocacy, especially for the younger generations. I saw how students' faces and demeanors on campus could change when they watched our advocacy VR video about refugees. I began to think about how powerful education has been in my own life. School has always been my escape, and it became my ticket out of a chaotic community slowly being swallowed up by drugs and violence. I understood how powerful knowledge can be. The DCS program specifically has changed my life, so maybe education is the key. Unfortunately, education, and especially higher education, are not perfect. Teachers do not always choose to empower their students, or core curriculum doesn't allow for it. In higher education, topics within the field can often be pushed to the edges and made to seem unimportant, as we have seen and felt sometimes here at WKU. But as Manning Marable explains, we are a multicultural society, and that means that being able to understand each other across cultures and other identities is absolutely critical to having a safe, equitable, and congenial society. If education is key, then we cannot continue to marginalize minority voices. I don't want any more refugees to go unnoticed, faceless, and unnamed. I'm tired of all these issues being pushed aside or downplayed. I want to talk to them, and I want to have open and honest discussions. Inspired by Robin DiAngelo's experiences leading race and diversity workshops, I learned how white fragility can blind us to the point where we no longer have the skills and capacity to have these types of discussions. I felt ill-equipped at times to stand up for social justice. And so this semester, through Dr. Olmsted and Leah Ashwell, I was fortunate enough to not only participate in, but also become a moderator for our deliberative dialogue on police brutality in Bowling Green and the larger community. This was a pivotal and phenomenal experience for me, as I gained skills in critical thinking without biases, moderating groups that don't always agree, and working to solve or eventually solve tough social issues. The deliberative dialogue process also challenged me to be more open, understanding, and creative in my thinking, listening, and problem solving. That is when I understood what Stroh said about being. He explained that as you build your capacity to think systemically, you will discover that the tools both enable and require you to develop a new way of being, not just doing. A set of character traits to cultivate, such as curiosity, compassion, and courage, that complement and deepen your new skills. Upon reflecting on my time here at WKU and in this program, I realized how much I have grown and learned, but more importantly, I feel that my heart has opened. Opened to the struggles of all types of people, opened to those I might not agree with, and opened to putting my heart and soul into my work and studies. I want to end with a tidbit that Dr. Olmsted told us earlier in the semester. It was one of our first meetings, and we were working on a short in-class writing assignment. As we each shared our writing, including Dr. Olmsted, she said something that stuck with me. She said that we need to make more room for the L word in academia, the L word being love. And now I understand what she meant, and I couldn't agree more.
Any questions?
Marilyn Fry's essay, how would you see the double bind working in some of these efforts for change?
So obviously, like with my work with refugees, there's a lot of struggle between to get them more recognition within the community and just have people know that they're there and notice them. But sometimes that recognition can also backfire, which I see as a double mind. You know, you become more well known in the community, but that also sometimes attracts people that don't necessarily want you there. And so then you have to deal with those kinds of unintended consequences and things like that. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely something that you have to think about all the time.
Okay, thank you.